Okay, good afternoon, everybody. In this noon slot of our presentation, this is the final day, last day. Our journey of 5 days is coming to an end. Our first season of presentations is coming to an end. This was a very unique experience. I don't think that we are going to have similar unique experiences next semester. Perhaps next semester we will be sitting in a classroom and we will be giving presentations rather than this online mode. So Corona has given us a very interesting opportunity to try out several things, and we are on the final day of all the problems about network and other things. Still, we are able to see that things can run if we wish. Then there is always a way that we can find it out. So on this final day, which started on 6th and 10th, today is the final day. Today's presentations are about history of the English literature. And in this slot, these students are going to make presentations. Khushbu, Kishan, Latta, Nandita, Nidhi, Niyati, Riddhi, Sneha, and Stuti. These students are going to make presentations in this slot. And the topics of your presentations are pertaining to history of English literature from Chaucer's age to Victorian times. And in the second semester, you are going to study 20th century literature. So in this slot, we will have Khushbu speaking on general literary characteristics of all ages. Kishan on introduction of the revival of learning age, Latta on comparison between Romantics and the Victorians, Nandita on Victorian literature as the queen of literature. Well, good topic has been given here. Nidhi on clowns and fools, that also is interesting, Shakespeare's work. Niyati on literary characteristics of Restoration age. Riddhi on how John Ruskin's Unto This Last inspired Mahatma Gandhi. Well, good topic. Sneha on Abraham Cowley's metaphysical as a metaphysical poet. And Stuti is going to speak on characteristics of neoclassical literature. From the morning slot, Bhargavi was not able to make presentation in the morning, so she is going to make presentation here, and she is going to speak on Victorian novel. Bhargavi, your turn will be the last one after this all our presenting. At that time, your turn will be there. Okay? Today, we are going to also see that how is your Google Classroom performance. During the entire semester, we have given you several thinking activities, online tests, as our format is, of teaching format is like, at the end of all the units, we give some tasks to students to think about it, points to ponder, and write a blog and submit their work in Google Classroom. And along with that, one online test based on that unit also is given to students, and you have performed throughout the semester. So today we are also going to evaluate how many of you were sincerely appearing in all the tasks and completing the work, and how many of you were a little bit lethargic in your work, so that we can come to know that in second semester how we have to work. Those who are able not doing work, they have to be very sincere, and those who are doing the work, they have to improve the quality of their work. Okay, so that also we'll keep on analyzing at the end of your presentations. We will not have a time for live questions, so we will ask everybody to put your questions in chat, and you have to answer in chat. Your question that is asked to you shall be answered in chat. Okay, so our first presenter for this last day is Khushbu. Khushbu, you can start your presentation.
Okay, so my topic is general characteristics, literary characteristics of all ages. Next. Okay, so here the first is the age of Chaucer, and it is the standardizing of English, a curious modern note, and Scottish literature. Here I have kept a photo of Chaucer, the writer of the main writer of this age, and in this age we find that French and English amalgam, French and English two languages were came to a mixture to form a standard English, and the foundation of English prose style became from this age. Then Scotland, for the first time, Scotland supplies a writer that is worthier. Next. Okay, the next is from Chaucer to Spenser. And here there was a very thin material. Quality of material means the quality and the quantity both were very less in this age. No poets were there, and prose was also very thin. Then here the development of grammar took place. And so if it were not Scottish poets, then age would be without any poems. Then professional actor and playwrights also came, so it became the age of drama also, means development of drama took place from here. Then so it was a season of germination, we can say, ritual impulse slowly awakening and waiting for the right moment. So next. Yes, Elizabethan age, which is of course very flowering age, we can say it was very fruitful age under the guidance of Queen Elizabeth. And here we can find that the main writer of the age was Shakespeare, of course. Religious toleration was there, social contentment was there, enthusiasm was there, and drama flourished maximum in this age, we can say. So the religious toleration, because Elizabeth favored both the parties, Protestant and Catholics both. So for the first time, the question of religious toleration was solved, and here there was freedom of mind was there. So there was a great literary stimulus. Literature developed very much in this age. Then so there was increase in wealth, improvement in living, opportunities for labor, and new social content. So almost all the classes of society were quite satisfied with this age. Then, of course, dreams and deeds increase side by side, and dream is ever greater than the deed. So that is the meaning of literature, and it was fulfilled in this age. Next. Yes, this is the Puritan age, and it is also known as the age of Milton. And I have kept the photo of the Milton, the greatest writer. It was the reaction, pressure of so historical events. Milton was the main writer. Metaphysical poets also came in this age, Cavalier poets. It was the expansion of prose and the collapse of drama, of course. And yes, we can, I would like to quote one line here, that a great year is not judged by the form on its surface, and certain austere laws and doctrines which we have ridiculed are but froth on the surface of the mighty Puritan current that has flowed steadily like a river of life through English and American history since the age of Elizabeth. So in this age there was austere standard of living. People were imposed unnatural restrictions in their lives. So of course all people were not happy. Even cinemas and theaters were banned in this age. So there was no kind of entertainment in this age. And so the unnatural restrictions were forced on people in this age. So of course in this age we cannot expect a good literature. Next. Okay, so here is a period of restoration, and the main writer is Dryden, of course. Then here the begins the French influence, sudden breaking away of all old standards. Dryden was the greatest writer, and he said that he was drawing the outlines of prose and poetry, and he had no teacher to instruct him. So there were no teachers. See, themselves had to frame the outlines of poem and the poetry, prose and poetry both. So it was two marked tendencies of their own, realism and preciseness, elegance of expression which marked out. Then from this we get the formalism for the prose and poetry both. An heroic couplet was also followed by Dryden himself. And This rules and laws which were adopted by Dryden and many writers of this age were accepted for the next 100 years. Next. Yes, this is 18th century age of the Pope, we can say. It was in this age prose developed maximum to its peak, and then it is also known as satire also took its maximum development in this age. And for the first time in this age, prose was at its peak, we can say. Rapidity and excellence and development of the literature and the prose itself. It was the graceful elegance of Edison's essays, the tours of figure of Swift, satire, artistic finish of Fielding's novels. In this age, the publishing houses were there, so books were published in this age, clubs and coffee houses, so people can go there and read various magazines and newspapers. Periodical writing also started in this age. It is often called the age of Queen, but Queen had no particular influence in the literature. We can say the Pope, Swift and Edison were the best satirists of this age. Yes, this is the age of transition, and these are the main points, double tendency, and it was a return to nature and not to bookish artificial knowledge. And in this age, political writing was also quite decreased. Even the great political writers were now no longer writing on political topics. It was enlightenment of sympathy for the poor and oppressed people. Spirit of new thinking was seen in the works of Voltaire. So here the new philosophy was seen in the works of Voltaire. Next. Age of Romanticism. This is particularly the age of poetry. In this age, women got the education, and so they were able to write. And we know that if women are given any opportunity, they are of course going to flourish. So here, women novelists came into age. They were given education, so they flourished like the best stars. They did their best in the novels. Then. Yes, Southey's prose was much more better. He was best in writing the prose. But as it was the age of poetry, so he was forced to write the verse in verse form in order to earn money. Then, and here that we can see that man's feelings and thoughts and all that without any kind of changes or any artificiality, they were allowed to free to follow their own fancy in their own way in the literature itself. Next. Yes, Victorian age. Here, Alfred Tennyson was the main writer of this age. It was the age of prose, moral purpose. So we can say that it was the age of newspaper, magazine and the modern novel. Novel was a successful method of presenting modern problems and the modern ideal, and also the pleasantest form of literary entertainment. So novel was also at its peak, and we can also say that some writers were like teachers in this age. Tennyson, Browning, Carlyle, Ruskin were like teachers of England. They had super faith in their message. So it was not, this age was not for arts, for art of art's sake. This was the age for moral purpose, that people should follow some moral values. So in this intellectual development was there, new education came, many reforms came in the society and all. So this was quite a good achievement in this age. And even international influences were also there in this age. Next. Yes, and this is the birth of modern literature. This education was very highly spread in this age. Enormous output, many books were written in this age. It was a literature of social purpose. And here also we can find the dominance of novels was there. And Thomas Gray and Robert Burns, they were the great poets of this, writers of this age. And various experiments were taking even in the literary forms also. So, next. Yes, here we have the portrait of Virginia Woolf. In this age, she wrote even the many good books like Mrs. Dalloway and To the Lighthouse, and these were her works. And there was a good influence of radio and cinema. So in this age, we can find that also. The Speed of Life was came as again cinema and radio was invented and came. So the life was at its very high speed. Then. Values were also a little breaking down in this age, but we can find that very good writers were there, like Virginia Woolf also. Next. Yes, in this 20th century, we find that modernism and postmodernism fragmented structure, and it was modernism means it was utopian and ideal world, but in postmodernism, it is totally opposite of that. people like skeptical, they're doubting everything. It was like they doubted everything, like modernism is like people only followed the rules for everyone. It was common for everyone. It was ideal and utopian kind of world. But postmodernism doubted everything. It and everything that they believe that every individual should have different truth, different rules, and not common for all. So they doubted everything. It was a skeptical type of thing, we can say. So modernism was totally, these both are opposite terms. And then next, yes, in this also we can find that Catherine Mansfield was the author of this age and a lady author. And this is her very quote in a letter she has written, that I choose not only the length of every sentence, but even the sound. After I had written, I read it aloud number of times, just as one would play over a musical composition. If a thing has really come up, it seems to me there must not be a single word out of place. So in this quotation, Catherine Mansfield shows her exactness, perfection in her work of art. Then next. These are my citations.
Okay, good. You can stop sharing the screen. Yes, and good. You work well on citations today. Alphabetically, arrangements and other things are given. One more step remains, and that is properly coordinating all the sources in your slides. I think in the next semester we will have a workshop, and then you will get an idea about that. Okay, so your let me share the screen about the Google Classroom performance. By and large, you have done good in Google Classroom. 85% you have got in Google Classroom. Still, the work is ongoing, and that is very good. The class average is around 69%. The entire class average is 69. So if you are above 69, means above 70, you have done good work. You can say you have done good above 70. If above 80 and near 90, excellent. You can consider if you are above almost 88 or 90 or 90 plus, then excellent work you have done. But 60 and more is considered very good. Below 69 is very poor. Below 69% if you have, then you need to work very hard in next semester. This was good. Khushbu's performance is good, and she has done all the work also regularly in due time. All the works are also submitted. Even in the presentations also, you work very hard in all the presentations, and they were reasonably well presented, very well presented also. Okay, so keep going the same way in semester two and subsequent semesters also. Okay, so the questions shall be asked in the chat, and the next presenter is Kishan.
Hello, I am audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, I would like to call Bhavyang. Please share your screen and my presentation. Hello everyone. Today I present going the revival of learning to introduction of the revival of learning as next. This time end of 100 years of war, and so start a new year war. So because throne position also empty, so two royal families fight one to another royal families. First royal family is House of Ark, and second family is House of Lancaster. So these two type of families one to another fight because collect the thorns. And that time so one thunder king of Henry the seventh, and he was married to Elizabeth, daughter of Ark. So two families combined that time, and first become of King Theodore. And Henry Theodore defected Richard III at the Battle of Bosworth Field, final stage of war. Next. So that time become and publish become a printing press. First printed in England, William Caston, and the same way Europe also printed John's Gutenberg. And that time so many published books. So all people read this book and again not follow the religion's thoughts. So helped in religion reformation that time, and so obviously literary rate increased in that times. Next. So reformation, Martin Luther also represent this type of work, movement against belief of Catholic Church, Luther against clergy who give indulgence, and wrote 95 theses nailed classed Wittenberg, started from Germany, moved to England because freedom that time give to king. You go to another country and learn to any this country language and come to our country and write down work. And same way also Switzerland developed prose. Next. So list of rulers and Tudor dynasty in that times. Henry VII, first king of Tudor. So he was married to Elizabeth, and he's a son of Henry VIII. Henry VIII married so many women. He was married to 6 times because he was not collect to son. So first wife of Catherine, Queen of Aragon, his daughter of Mary the First, and second wife of Queen Anne Boleyn, his daughter of Elizabeth the First, and third wife of Jane Seymour, his son of Edward VI. Next. After king death become a queen, his son Edward the VI, and he was supported also Protestant religion, and after become a lady Jane Grey, and after become Mary the First, his daughter, so he was supported also Catholicism, Catholic religion, and finally this is this time and the last queen become Elizabeth the First, and she was supported also both religion, and Elizabeth the first become a queen that time start Elizabethan age. Next. So that time of revival of learning, so many is learning in that time, because king freedom to go to another country and you learn to any language and you come our country and write down work. So that time learn a new language and find out Columbus America and our India, and that time so of darkness is so. Writer go to another country and he was thoughts and new literature write down. That time people's also alignment and of the human minds. So that time new reformation and new think and new create literature. So that time start a Renaissance time. Next. Renaissance and humanism. So also I am explain Renaissance start this time, and Renaissance means rebirth, dark age to people darkest thoughts to new think people's modern thoughts, and that time study and read classic literature, not old literature. Next, so literature of the revival, as that time so many writer not so many writer write down the work, but some minor and some few writer work of this age. First is Rojas Assam, and second is Ersum. So Rojas Assam, famous classical scholar, he was published a book Thosophiles, and he was also dedicated of Henry the Eighth. Next, and other writer of Thomas More, he was also against to Henry VIII, and he was a very satirical and political satire in his work, and he was write down one book of Utopia. And another writer of William Tyndale, William Tyndale is he was a translator and Bible translator, and his work of New Testament. Next, the father of English sonnet, in that times two writers find out the sonnets. First one is Sir Thomas Waite. Sir Thomas Waite give two sonnet introduction and last two sonnet couplet, and another is Surya. So he was first published English blank verse, and he was also give a sonnet structure and meters. Next, and another writer is Thomas Marlowe. Thomas Marlowe's write down in one work Mort d'Arthur, and some minor writer in that times is Alexander Berkeley and John Calton. Next, so this revival of learning, so many event and so many new things. First one is end of 100 years war, and start a War of Roses, and Renaissance start, and humanism, and that reformation, and printing machine start, and so many writer write down some new work in this time. Next, next. Thanks.
Okay, so now say this, you, if you are referring to the book, no, William Long's history, then there is no need to refer to this blog. That is englishpathshala.wordpress.com. If you refer to original book, it is more authentic than the blog. So then there is no need to put the blog link. If that is another blog that you are referring to, like English Ki Pathshala, then if you do not have the name of the writer, then that blog remains unreliable. Like it, the authenticity decreases if the writer's name is not revealed on the blog. So that is very important, that whoever is the writer, the identity is revealed on the blog. Okay, fine. Yes, you can stop sharing the screen. And your performance in Google Classroom is very, very good, excellent. You can say, I think you are at the top with 91% in Google Classroom performance. So very regularly, you have done all your work. In Google Classroom, all your blogs were also very excellent. Blogs were very good. Your test performance, online test performance also was very good. The only thing you need to improve is your speech. So you need to work on your speech so you can speak with proper tonation, intonations. So it goes like flat. Instead of going flat, you can have tone and intonations in your speech, and you can improve some of the pronunciations also. So keep on speaking all alone, keep on speaking, keep on recording your voice in your mobile device and keep on listening. So slowly and steadily, even that part will be improved. But your regularity is excellent. Very well, all the work is being done by you. Many other students may get a lesson from you for being very sincere and regularly in completing all the works here. Okay. Okay, so the next presenter is Lata.
Yes, sir. I'm audible, sir.
Yes, you are audible.
For my presentation, I would like to request Nidhi. So, good afternoon, everyone, respected sir and dear friends. Today I am going to compare Romantic Age and Victorian Age, the paper of History of English Literature. The next slide. The Romantic Age. If we see that Romantic Age influenced and there are three major moments which can influence the age. The first is Industrial Revolution, the second is American Independence, and the third is French Revolution. The term Romantic derives from Old French Romance. If we talk what is Romantic Age, the first thing is arrive in our mind that it is about romance between a girl and man, but it is not meaning in that way, but romantic means the love toward nature, the love of nature. The next slide. So why this age come? If we talk about 18th century, neoclassical age, the age of prose and reason, age of pop, we can see that in that age, the most of work are most of works are depend on reason, that if anything is happened, then it is obviously there is behind reason. So also that's why is it age is known as prose and reason. So people get tired from this pattern. They wanted something new. So in that case, the main feature of Romantic Age was a reaction against the 18th century and the age. Edge of reason. They don't want reason, but want to think independent. So that's why Romantic developed an alternative aesthetic of freedom from the formal rules of neoclassicism. The people of Romantic Age write about nature, and we can see here is the one famous quotation about nature by William Wordsworth, and the quotation is the slides is not visible properly. Yes, okay, thank you. The previous slide. Yeah. The quotation is that, come forth into the light of things, let nature be your teacher. Because William Wordsworth is belong to Romantic Age, he write about nature. If we see the example of daffodils, you can see the William Wordsworth is praising the nature and using different elements of nature in his poem. It is one of his best known poem about nature. Next. After the Romantic Age, the Victorian Age is come. The bright, sunny, cheerful romanticism ended, and a new sun rose. that did not lighten up the day, but threw light on the realities of life. If we see in romantic age, age gives an idea about emotion, feelings, independence, nature. This all is not given realities. It is like a dream. So in Victorian age, the Victorian age is provide realities. Realities, it means to wake up from a dream. Next. This age is known as Victorian age because of Queen Victoria rule over the country, and the age was witness of rapid and sweeping changes. Everything is going very speedily, so the age is witness of these all changes. If we see that in romantic age there were many complexity of the in social forces, it changed the thinking pattern of people, because romantic people are thinking about nature, emotions, feeling about their dreamy world, but in Victorian age the people are thinking about science and technology and scientific pattern. So it also changed the thinking pattern of all people. This era afford to its citizens not all beautiful things, but all that was necessary to give the century a new turn. As I earlier talked that this age is not given the beautiful things, but it gives that what is necessary for people and the country for a new invention and a new turn. Next. So here I am giving my comparison between romantics and Victorian age. The period of 1798 to 1837 is known as a romantic age, and the time of 1837 to 1901 is known as a Victorian age. Romantic age didn't have any king or queen, but in a Victorian age we can see that the Queen Victoria is ruled over the country. The romantic age is influenced by nature, but Victorian age is influenced by industrial revolution. If we talk, then industrial revolution is influenced both of age, but Victorian age is very much influenced by industrial revolution. Next. The romantic age is focused on literature of art, but Victorian age is focused on science and technology. They want a realistic picture, so they focused on science and technology. The poetry is a popular form of romantic age, and drama is a popular form of Victorian age. If we see main elements of Victorian age, we can find that all works are imaginative, fictitious, fabulous, extravagant, fanciful, bizarre, exaggerated, and chimerical. But if we talk about Victorian age, that main elements of its work are faith and doubt, morality and hypocrisy, idealism and materialism, progress and decline, splendor and squalor. Next. The main theme of the romantic literature is the imagination, emotion, and nature. But if we talk about Victorian age, the main themes in its work are science and technology, and the second is democracy. The major writers of this age is William Blake, Robert Burns, William Wordsworth, S.T. Coleridge, Walter Scott, Robert Southey and Charles Lamb. It is the first generation of the Romantic Age, and in second generation we can see Jane Austen, Mary Shelley, P.B. Shelley are the included in second generation, and the Alfred Lord Tennyson, Robert Browning, Rudyard Kipling, Thomas Hardy, Oscar Wilde, and D.G. Rossetti, and Matthew Arnold is a major writer of Victorian age. We studied Oscar Wilde's The Importance of Being Earnest, and we can see that it is a shows the reality of the age. So we can see that the Victorian age is shows the reality. It is necessary for people. Next. So here is my citation, which I took references from them, and thank you.
Okay, good. Good citations were mentioned, and well prepared presentation also. Your performance in Google Classroom also is very good. You have 84, almost 85% in this, and so you also have displayed very good regularity and sincerity in completing all your works also. So keep on doing the same thing in the subsequent semesters also. Okay, next is Nandita.
Yes, sir.
Just let me remind everybody to keep on asking questions in the chat and also replying there.
Morning. On his in presentation, or we can topic.
Your voice is breaking, Nandita. Yes, Nandita, your voice is breaking. We are not able to listen you clearly. I think there is even your presentation slide is also not visible. Okay, I think you try disconnect and then find a better space if there is a low network from where you are presenting. Okay. And then connect again. Right now we are not able to listen you. Okay. Now your slides are visible. Your slides are visible, but your voice is not audible. Your voice is not audible, Nandita. We are not able to listen you. Yes, we can see your slides, but your voice is not audible. Yeah, so we are taking, are you speaking, or shall we take another turn and then we are coming back to you? Okay, we'll come back to her. Okay, next presenter is Nidhi.
Hello everyone, good afternoon. Today I'm going to present about the clones and fools in Shakespeare's works. So I'm going to share my screen. Let me know if it's visible or not. Hello.
Yes, Nandita, we are not able to listen your voice. I think you need to be in a better network space, or maybe a good network you have to connect with. Maybe low bandwidth, because of which your voice is not reaching here.
Is my slides visible, sir? Hello.
Just a minute. Yes, now it is visible.
Okay, yes, so guys start. And respected sir, I'm going to represent the clones and fools in William Shakespeare's work. So first introduction that what
we are taking other turn now. You wait for the turn. We have started with Nidhi's presentation now.
So introduction. So first of all, the thing is, what do you mean by the fool? Okay, fool or jester would have been known by many of those in Shakespeare's contemporary audience, as they were often kept by the royal court and such a real household to act as the entertainers, and they were a male as well as the actor, and would wear the flamboyant clothing and carry a bubble, cowed and stick to use their jokes. So it is the image that which kind of the fools we can imagine, or that kind of performance they have to do. Fool and clowns is very useful term in the works of Shakespeare, and we can say that it was the Shakespeare who first time introduced some new kind of ingredients in his drama. So including the old fools and the clowns, they enrich the quality of drama. Fools play a very significant role in the drama. Shakespeare divide the two fools in a two distinction. So first is that who is a wise and intelligent, and second one is that they are naturally fools, means they are a fool by her nature, and another is the fools. They are looking at a fool, but by the nature they are more intellectual. So he has apparently been there for some time, as he was a fool of the lady Oliver's father, took a much delight in. Some of the well-known fools of the Shakespeare's work is the Touchstone, Fist, Lear's Fool, Lanes, Bottom, Doggerby, and as we know that Porter we have studied in our Macbeth. So we aware the term of the fools, that how Porter play a very significant role in a drama of Macbeth. So first I would like to start it with the Touchstone. Touchstone is the first use of fool in the work, and Touchstone is the fool of work As You Like It of William Shakespeare. Touchstone is the court jester of Duke Frederick's upstairs court, and I would like to quote it, his best quote, and the quote is, "The fool doth think he is a wise, but the wise man knows himself to be a fool." So by this byline we can aware that that Touchstone is the name. It's very significant, touch and stone. If we are divided this both name, that we can find that Touchstone means touch something, stone which is marvelous, that he knows that who is a wise and who is a foolish. So Touchstone is a very wise fool, and his play is very significant in the As You Like It. And the next is the Fist. Fist is the fool of the Twelfth Night. He's attached to the household of the court Oliver, and I would like to quote his best quotation, and is that, "Why, some are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have a greatness through upon them." And he has apparently been there for some time, and he was the fool of the lady Oliver's father, took much a delight. The another is Lear's fool. Lear's fool belong to the King Lear, and the fool is Lear's one stand up, a comedian, sure, but more intensively, and he is the only guy that Lear allowed to criticize him. And so we can say that Shakespeare used the fools and clowns to reveal the foolishness and the trivial nature of the king, because that time no has right or no has a power to criticize the king. So by the introducing this element, Shakespeare describe or discuss some vices, some foolish nature, some trivial mentality of king of that time, because the fool has all rights on a king, and people think that they are a fool, so they speak sparingly. So whatever they speak, it will be taken as a light label. Fools, they all are speak very sad and very reality of that particular time. Remember when Kent lips of Lear puts him out of the kingdom, and when Lear doesn't like what Cardellia has to say, Lear dissolve her altogether. It is one incident from the King's Lear, that King Lear foolishness described by the Lear's fool. This is the article written by the Christian, and I have taken it from the OUP blog. Then next is the lens. It is a fool belonged to the work of two gentlemen of a Verera. He was a Proteus servant and not a brightest. He occasionally mix up his big words. The next is Bottom. Bottom is my one of the favorite fool, and Bottom play a very significant role. He is the fool of Midsummer Night Dreams. When we read the drama, we can find that throughout the play, we can found the Bottom scenes in every act. Bottom, especially her gesture, her wearing manner, and Shakespeare also include some supernatural elements or supernatural power in the hand of fools or jester or in the clowns. Bottom, the weaver, is a take a charge short of the fellow, and the greatest stage harm who wishes to play all the part, and he is a queen's play. So Bottom's, I would like to quote some lines which is very marvelous, and I have taken it from the original word. And is that, I have had a most rare vision. I have had a dream past the wit of the man to say what dream it was. Man is but an ass if he go about to expound this dream. So we can found that Bottom is as a look, he is a hopeful, but he is not a fool in a true sense. He is a wise than a man. The another is Rogerby, and from it is taken from the Much Ado About Nothing, and the constable in charge of the watch, or the chief policeman of the machina. Rogerby is a very sincere and taken his job seriously, but he has a habit of using the wrong word to convey his meaning. So we can found that how they look, that is his dressing, his speaking way. He speaks very ironically and metaphorically. So people cannot understand, but they were going to deeper meaning. They realize their vices and foolishness. And here, especially, I have mentioned the porter from the Macbeth, and I have taken the original lines of the porter. And I must describe the Porter saying that Porter is posted at the gate. He's a drunk, he's a sound sleepy, and after the performance of Duncan's murder, loudly knocking at the herd at the gate. And the porter is awake by the repeating the knocking with the unconscious irony, and he imagined himself as the porter of a hell gate. He become angry while approaching the door when the repeating knocking is heard. And he become angry and ask who it was. He says that Macbeth's castle is too cold for hell. He says that he will not act a devil porter again. And then he come to himself and open the door and admit Macduff and Lennox. From the point of view, the audience, the porter scene is the most humorous and the enjoyable thing of the drama. And its dramatic importance is great. It provides comic relief in the very serious scene. The dramatic irony and become the porter. And he says that the place is too cold for the hell. It's a picture of the hell in Macbeth's castle. So we can say that at the gate, he play a comic role, but he play a very significant role, and he described the castle of Macbeth. It's like a hell. And and we can found the photo of the porter. That porter is, by the look wise, he looks a fool, he is a drunken, but by the use of this kind of gestures, this kind of the fools, Shakespeare Shakespeare described the reality and ironically and metaphor of the whole scene. So I have also cited or also mentioned the article based on the clones and fools of the Shakespeare, and it's a very well-known articles based on the all the work of the particular drama and particular drama and clones and fools. So these first articles is from BBC News, and in this article it describes the modern equivalence, that how in the modern time of fools or any kind of thing, that idea they are very vital role. And I would also mention the movie that in the beginning of the scene we can found that Ranveer Kapoor wears like a roboting. So there's kind of that kind of a scene is like a fools or clowns scene. But they describe the reality, the virtue of the human beings. So, and the another article is from the E Times, and it is the it describes the one of our hearts, that beside the protagonist, audience are more fascinating or more enjoying the scene of Porter. And it's a, it's not out that it's a laughing, but it provides a moral lesson to us. So there's both articles are very notable. And these are article I it's written by the Siri, and it was published in a scholarship, a Clomid. And I would like to quote the two important line, that the fool, what is the meaning of fool? So Sir Siri described it, the fool in a picture is one, and Shakespeare created character of the fool characters as a diverse in the personality as they are in a proposed. And I would also like to give you a definition, that the fool in the life and a literature is an ending character over the course of history. He appear under the different title and a different form. He is sometimes identified by his physical angility or by the physical deformation, and by his sharp wit or by his utter stupidity. So we can found that it will be the trait to the including the fools and describe the vices of human nature. So it is my citation about my presentation, and thank you. It's my presentation about the fools and clowns of William Shakespeare's works.
Yeah, okay, very well presented. Good citations also you have taken, and you have tried to integrate within your slides also. That is a good improvement over the previous presentations. And your Google Classroom performance also is very good. More than 89% you have. And again, very sincerely, you have submitted all your work throughout the semester, right from the beginning. Most of your works were submitted in due time, and you do not see like barely one or two done late only. Otherwise, the things are submitted in due time, and that is a good thing. So continue doing the same kinds of work in subsequent semesters also. Okay, so next, Nandita, are you ready? Nandita is ready?
Yes, sir, I'm ready.
Yeah, okay, then we can take your turn. Yes.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, respected sir and dear friends. Today, my presentation is on the Victorian literature as a queen of literature. I had personified the Victorian literature as the queen, because it is a queen, because the same thing or the same virtues we can see in the Victorian literature, other than many of literature that we are having. The points that have been covered in this presentation is the timeline of literary ages, which conclude the whole English literature, major events of the history, Victorian periods, its writers, its important works marked innovations and the Gothic paintings. This is the timeline of British literary history. The first is Old English period, which we know from the Beowulf, then the Middle English, then Renaissance by Shakespeare, Neoclassical Age, Romantic by obviously in our previous presentations we had talked about Frankenstein, the Victorian period, that is the publishment of Oliver Twist, poem or a novel of Charles Dickens, then the Edwardian period, Peter Pan with this, Georgian period, modern period and postmodern period. Here I had marked the important events in throughout the, our history. All the presentators has already presented the characteristics. So I thought to pick up the major events of each literary period. So for the Old English period, obviously, if we just imagine the Old English period, we just caught into our mind the term Beowulf. In Middle English period, we find that there is enhancement in language also, in grammar and in terms of vocabulary also. In Renaissance, the most famous art was the painting of Mona Lisa, which is done by Leonardo da Vinci, and is another famous painting was The Last Supper. Then we come to the Neoclassical age. We gone through the Rococo style of painting. Rococo style of painting just delivers the type of nature, the calmness of nature, the sweetness of nature. Another thing is the Romantic age. Romantic age depicts to the turn to nature, as in the earlier literary ages, the literature was going on through the peoples, through the diversity, through social criticisms also. But in a Romantic age, Romantic age is equal to the age of nature also. The amazing poet we also have, which is William Wordsworth. The another is Victorian age. Victorian age has the element of the Queen Victoria. But the main important or invention of Victorian age, we can say it is a telephone. Another, the Edwardian period. The Edwardian period is signified by the World War I. And that follows the Georgian period. Georgian period also have the same significance as the earlier literary periods also. It is known by the industrializations of the England. The another one is the modern period. Modern period has the printing press, which is very important for our literary period. The most significant or amazing or the favorite of almost all the literary students is the postmodern period. And here is the visual art, especially surrealism and dadaism. Salvador Dali has the most significant figure of this art also. It depicts the way if we just read a book, we got an inscriptions of those characters in our mind. But these types of visual arts are arts which we just see, and it is type of a quiz. We cannot find that what that picture is trying to saying to us. So it is very difficult to signify what the painting is saying to us. And this is the timely events of all the literary periods. When we came to the Victorian period is a scene and like between the Romanticism, 18th century and 20th century, the novel as genres rose to the enlightenment and entertainment of the people of society. It is also the changing society of the turn. In history, United Kingdom also, and the Victorian era is the era of the Queen, and Georgian period precedes its Edwardian period after it. It is also in the constitutional of Europe also. The other Victorian literatures is when we get the term literature in our mind, we just thought of William Shakespeare, his dramas and the printing press and all those things just got into our mind. Victorian period loved the heroic stories, knights of an old, and they hope to regain some of that nobles' courtly behavior and impresses it upon the people of the home. Some famous writers of Victorian period are Robert Browning, the Bronte sisters, Emily Bronte, Charlotte Bronte, Charles Dickens, William Wordsworth, and Lewis Carroll also. Here, Queen Victoria has quoted wonderful lines through which we can signify the importance of Victorian literature is this. We will not have failure. Queen Victoria wants to depict that we will not have failure, but the only success and new learning. So here is the way of learning revival from starting to the old age, through the Victorian era and to the present time also. The another important Victorian literature are Chenaire, which is written by Charlotte Bronte, Wuthering Heights by Emily Bronte, Mr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde is a very significant art of a novel, which is signified by the character of which also includes the science and fiction, both of them in a very depict and colloquial way. And then Charles Dickens' Bleak House, Great Expectations, and William Makepeace, a very important, and last but not the least, a Vanity Fair, a novel without a hero. These all the important characteristics, or we can say the important works of the literary period of Victorian age. What is Victorian age is marked by? Victorian age is marked by the rapid growth of industry, rise of the power of the middle class. Here, the main thing which is significantly known by us is that in Victorian literature, in Victorian art or Victorian age also, the people are finding something which is very depictful or which is very weird. The middle class people were trying to focus upon their new learning, new revival of the things. They are, feeling that now industrial revolution has come and we are going to have another thing in our life. So it is a positive aspect, but at the same time, there are negative aspects also. Here, science are reflected and literature cause the growth disillusionment in a traditional moral values. Another thing is the Victorian times. In 1837, Queen Victoria become the Queen of England. In 1837 also, the first commercial electric telegraph was invented by William Cooke. And in 1838, the most significant, we can say, the rule has been done is the slavery was abolished in the Victorian era. Around 7 lakh slavers has been freed. So the year 1838 in Victorian era is the freedom, we can say it is the freedom movement or Republic Day for Independence Day for all the peoples, all the slavers out there. In 1839 also, the first photography was commercially introduced. Photography, telegraph, telephone, all these inventions are marked in the Victorian era. And in 1840, the first adhesive stamp was established. In 1840, Queen Victoria married his cousin. Queen Victoria married her cousin, and his name was Albert. He was the Prince of Germany. And in 1842, the first mine was established, introducing banning all the women's and children's above the age of 10 years. So the main important aspect of Victorian era is also the abolishing of slavery. Also, it has many widespread of literature also, but by the freedom of people is also as important as the other things. Here, the very important thing is the Gothic painting. Gothic painting deserves the objects merely shows symbols. It shows the symbols. Here, on the left side, we can see the good and evil Gothic. In good and evil, there is a person who is convicted upon both things. In the upper side, there is God, and in the downwards, there is the evil, which is making him or straining him downwards. In our personal life also, we have the two devils. One, we can say our heart is equals to God and our mind is equals to devil. One is pulling our upwards and one is pulling downwards. The Gothic painting also have some important and realistic features of the age. We can say that Gothic painting has no perspective at all, but we can say that it is related with surrealism and dadaism also, and it also includes the religious themes. The right side picture is the Gothic kitchen. If we just look at a glance over here, we just find there is a skull of a human being. But if we just deeply watch that picture, we can find that there is a woman who is sitting in her kitchen and utensils on her table, and she is imagining herself on her own mind. And this is a picture of which can signify the way that how women or how people of that age are belonging to one and another. So all we can say that our Victorian literature or Victorian period is a period that talked about the main inventions and with the literary figures also, literary works also, the inventions are the greatest things over there. And William Somerset Maugham has also quoted one thing, that Victorian literature is the instinct of every literature, is the instinct of every literature, and we are following it as a baby. He signifies the term baby here, which is in Victorian literature there is not that much significance of the work, but it is also known by the term of Queen Victoria and by the more inventions, by freedom of slavery also, and inventions at all. So it is a term baby related to it, that people are not signified the literary works, but Victorian era, if we just take a glance of Victorian era, we just find more and more inventions and more revival of learning of Queen Victoria. So this was my presentation, and thank you.
Yeah, okay, good. Well presented. It was good. Good slides were prepared. Good images were also. Many of you are using very good images. Today morning also we have seen that beautiful slides were prepared. Even in this lot also, many of you have prepared very good slides with paintings and sculptures, also architectural designs also. Yes, and Nandita, your performance in Google Classroom is also good, 76. So class average is 70%. So you are on the positive side of the class average. So that is good. Initially, you have done lots of work very late. So the classroom reflects that not many things are done late. But later on, you started working and most of the things are submitted in due time. And I hope in the next semesters also you will remain regular in submitting all your works, thinking activities, online tests and other things. Your command of English language is very good. Your speech also is very good. So that is a good aspect that you have with you, and a little bit of working on literary sensibilities, understanding literary sensibilities, and that can really improve your performance in a better way. Also, but your speech is good. So other students, those who like try to learn, like Kishan, I was telling that you need to improve your speech. So you can take sample examples from your classroom itself. Some of the classmates are speaking very well. In the morning also, 2-3 presenters. Here also, we have Nandita, Nidhi is there, Riddhi is there. They are speaking very well. So other students can take them also as a good example and try to improve their speeches in a similar way. Okay, so next presenter for today is Niyati.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So here I will present about literary characteristics of Restoration period. So the Restoration period of English literature roughly lasts from 1660 to 1688. It begins with Charles II returning to the throne following the rules of various republican governments that ruled England from 1649 to 1659 after Charles I was executed. An act of restoring, or the condition of being restored. One of the most immortal and interesting aspect of literature is the way that it both responds responds to and is inevitably shaped by the political context in which is written. Some of the best examples of his of these can be found in the Restoration period, which lasts from 1660 to around 1688. The name Restoration comes from the crowning of Charles II, which marks his restoring to the traditional English monarchical from the government following a short period of rule by a handful of Republican governments. The age is also known as the age of French influence. In this age, Charles has returned to the throne. The progress of liberty plainly turned backward. It had repressed to many natural pleasures. As per W.J. Long says, an entire generation following the Restoration age in 1660, England lay sick of fever. After the fever, England has come slowly to health. There was a corruption in the society, but the character of people was strong. There are five literary characteristics of Restoration age. First is French influence. Second is new tendencies. Third is realism. Fourth is formalism, and the last one is the couplet. And I will talk about now French influence. It was the time of French influence, where people are getting bored with reading about witches, ghosts, murder, king and queen, warrior, history. And now you all come to know whom do I talking about. So I want to ask you all, hello?
Yes, go on, yeah.
Sir, I want to ask something.
Yes, you go on, ask here.
Whom do I talking about? Like, which writer includes these elements in his place? I would like to ask you all. Khushbu, Nidhi, Nandita, Bhav, Kishan Bhai, anyone of you?
Nidhi, repeat your question.
Yes? What?
Repeat your question.
Oh, I want to ask that which writer includes all of these elements in his place, like witches, king and queens, murders, ghosts, histories, warrior.
Shakespeare?
Yes.
Right. William Shakespeare.
Yes. William Shakespeare. People are getting bored about reading about Shakespeare's plays. He only includes these elements, which is a ghost and about king and queens, suicide. People are getting bored. Like we have in Macbeth, we have ghost of Banquo, and in Hamlet, we are meeting with ghost of Hamlet's father. So it was the time of French influence, and people don't like to read about Shakespeare's plays, like Hamlet, King Lear, Macbeth, and etc. So literary writers began to imitate the French writers. The second is new tendencies. When all the writers of Restoration one have rejected all the styles, there was a serious crisis. The old Elizabethan spirit, its love and romance, and the moral spirit of Puritanism were the things of post. Literature is the aggression art. the education art writers have developed too much influence, too much a tendency of their own, the tendency of realism and tendency of preciseness. And here is the realism. Realism is representation of reality and representation of men as they are. It is just a plain expression of truth rather than having ideals of romance. The tendency was first not expected. The restoration wanted to point corrupt court and society. Most of the writers don't wrote about inner beauty, idealism, their facts. They only wrote about their outer appearance. Most of writers have observed the outer appearance of men rather than presenting its soul and ideas. This tendency to realism become more wholesome. Now formalism. This tendency was about directness and simplicity of expression. In both Elizabethan and Puritanism ages, the general tendency of writers was to write decorative words. Sentences were having Latin quotations and classical allusions. The Restoration writers opposed this. From France, they brought new tendency. They have established rules for writing to use short, clear-cut sentences without unnecessary words. Like they want short sentences. They don't like about in details and long details. Here is the couplet. Another thing was heroic couplet, which Restoration literature has adapted in the age. This was most suitable from the poetry form of the poetry. Valor is regarded as the father of this couplet. Chaucer has used this rhymed couplet in his Canterbury Tales. And here I missed out some information about Restoration, about major writers of Restoration age. I will talk about major writers of Restoration age. So we have John Dryden. Charles II may have been the king of England, but John Dryden was king of Restoration period. And then we have William Congreve. He is most important playwright of Restoration age. And then John Milton. And here the period saw. And here the period saw. The period saw most. No, the period saw first female professional playwright, who is Aphra Behn. Okay, thank you.
And completed?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, you can stop sharing the screen, Hiral. Good, well presented, Niyati. Yeah? And your performance in Google Classroom is around 78%. That also is on the positive side of class average. Yeah? More than 70%, that is good. Still, the maximum points are 91%, 91, 19, 88. That is the highest. So you can strive to get that in the next semester by your performance in your thinking activities and in the unit and exams, online exams. If you perform well, you can get the things done well. Initially, your work was submitted a little bit late, but then you were regular. Later on, you submitted everything quite regularly also. Okay, fine. So keep doing this work in the subsequent semesters also. Okay, the next speaker is Riddhi.
Yes, sir. My screen is visible, sir.
Yes, it is visible. Now you can start.
Okay, thank you, sir. So, hello, beautiful people. Good afternoon, respected sir and my all dear friends. Today we are discuss about our paper number 105, History of English Literature from 1350 to 1900. And my topic is how John Ruskin's Unto This Last inspired Mahatma Gandhi. John Ruskin is a from a Victorian era, and he was a very good art critic and a good social thinker. So here is a key objective. So first we see that who is John Ruskin, then words of Ruskin, polemical strategy in Unto This Last as a literature, and Gandhiji and Ruskin's Unto This Last. So first we see that briefly who is John Ruskin. So John Ruskin born at 8 February 1819. Then died at 20 January 19 in age 80. His occupation is like a writer, art critic, draftman, watercolorist, social thinker, and he was from a Victorian era. There are some notable work of John Ruskin, and then subjects. So geology, architecture, myth, literature, education, botany, and political. And John Ruskin writing theme based on highly influential to works of other British, namely designer William Morris and architect Philip Webb, both considered pioneer of the art and craft movement in Britain. So here are words of John Ruskin. First one is the Virtue of Architecture, Stone of Venice, Volume 1. And second one is quote is from The Lamp of Memory, The Seven Lamps of Architecture. This architecture is to be regarded by us with the most serious thought. We may live without her and worship without her, but we cannot remember without her. Second point is that Unto This Last is a literature. So Ruskin is a brilliant prose stylist with a rare gift for striking and memorable phrases. The prose style of Unto This Last mixes argument, satire, and deeply moving statements of his hopes for moral regeneration. Ruskin very consciously wrote Unto This Last in a simple style than his art criticism, so that it could be more widely read. Even so, his complex prose is difficult for modern readers. Although the book's structure is eccentric, Ruskin regards to Unto This Last as his best writing book. Unto This Last is a deeply masterpiece, and his polemical strategy into Unto This Last. So Ruskin challenges the privileging economic thinking of his day. Orthodox theory supported laissez-faire capitalism and represented human being motivated only by the desire for financial gain. Ruskin never bothers about data or statistics. Ruskin redefines key economics term from a humanistic and a Christian perspective. Then what Ruskin wants in Unto This Last and Ruskin view, we see that Ruskin demands that the business elite improve the condition of the lower class out of moral responsibility. Though no socialist, Ruskin proposes government intervention in regard to education, vocational training, and more. Ruskin wants employers agree on rates of pay for each category of work and given workers more employment security than their labor. Ruskin was a very early environmentalist who recognized how much human beings lose when they are denied sunlight, fresh air, and open meadow. Ruskin wants political economics to focus much more on how well people live. Second, our main point is that Gandhiji and Ruskin's Unto This Last. So in Gandhiji's biography, Satyena Prayogo, that Gandhiji said that the book was impossible to set aside. Once I had begun, it gripped me. Then I could not get any sleep that night. Sounds like a thriller. No, I determined to change my life in accordance with the ideal of the book. Recounts the experience in his autobiography in a chapter titled The Magic Spell of a Book. Also, Gandhiji say this book that brought about and practical transformation in my life. This was because he discovered some of my despite conventions reflect in his great book. Gandhiji summarized unto this last teaching in these 3 points. That first one is that the good of the individual is contained in the good of all. Second one is that that a lawyer's work has the same value as the barber's, in as much as all have the same right of earning their livelihood from their work. And the third one is that a life of a laborer, example, the life of the tiller of the soil and the handicraftman, is the life worth living. The book gripped Gandhiji so much that its teaching of the book appealed to Gandhiji instantly, and Gandhiji perhaps into Gujarati as a Sarvodaya, the welfare of whole. So here is a Sarvodaya's image, and there are my references, and thank you so much.
Yeah, okay, well presented. So this topic becomes a part of Victorian literature. Within that, you have compared both these works. Your Google Classroom performance is also good, around 77-78%. That is on the positive side of the class average. But still, you can score more 10% if you try to work hard in, I think, the tests. Maybe perhaps in the tests or in the blogs you got less marks. So it is 77-78%. And your speech also is good. Language also is good. Language command also is very good in your speech and even in your writing also. Okay? So keep doing the good work in the subsequent semesters also. Okay, next is Sneha.
Yes. Good afternoon, everybody. Let me share my screen. I share my screen from Daya's device.
Okay, now the I think the PPT you submitted in Google Classroom is not opening. It is asking for request access. So this mistake, you'll have to see that how you are doing. So quickly submit after your presentation. Quickly submit again in Google Classroom so I can have a look at it. Right now it's not opening.
So today I would like to
continue. Yeah, continue.
So today I would like to present on a history of English literature. Today my topic is Abraham Cowley as a metaphysical poet. First of all, metaphysical poetry. The word meta means beyond the meta means beyond, and physical means physical nature. Metaphysical poetry refers to a type of very intellectual poetry. It is a type of poetry dealing with abstract or philosophical subjects such as love, religion, God, beauty, faith, and so on. The term metaphysical or metaphysical in a poetry is the fruit of Renaissance tree. Originally, the term metaphysical poetry was coined by John Ryder, and later popularized by Samuel Johnson in his book Lives of the Most Eminent English Poets. So Abraham Cowley is a metaphysical poet. He was born in 1618. He was died in 28 July 1667. He was English poet and essayist of the metaphysical and neoclassical periods. He was first used the Pindaric ode from in English poetry. During the 1668 and 1721, for his 14th printing of his work published, his Miscellaneous and the Mistress work reflect the theme and motifs of the metaphysical poets. David Ives and Unfinished Epic in couplets and the Pindaric odes are neoclassical in their restraint, and his essays in verse and prose reflect the influence of Montaigne's essays. Cowley sided with the royalist and cause during the Civil War. About his writing style, Kavli tend to use grossly elaborate, self-consciously poetic language that decorated, rather than expressed his feelings. He wrote verse imitating the intricate rhyme scheme of Edmund Spenser. He used a new technique to write poems with irregular imbic scheme, patterns and rhyming techniques known as the Pindaric Ode, which is one of the most famous work. This consisted of imbic pentameters and phrases of irregular lines with a unique rhyming scheme. Abraham Kavli's works were inspired by the works of Pindar, an ancient Greek poet. He was mesmerized by the unique rhyming system and decided to develop on the same. Here is his major works. Some of his major works include The Mistress or several copies of Love Verses. Second is Poetical Blossoms. Third is Poems 1656, New Framing Locular. The first Neimen Ode of Pindar, the Rescuration, Virtue written on several occasions, Deep Lands Libri, Tragical History of Pyramus and Thisbe, the Civil War. His major work, major work of his, The Mistress. This work is published in 1647. He exaggerated John Donne's metaphysical wit, jarring the reader's sensibilities by unexpectedly comparing quite different things into what later test itself was fanciful poetic nonsense. This work is one of limited edition of number of copies. The present work includes a very poem of eminent merit, drawn from every period of Kavli's work. The Mistress is a collection published in 1647 that quickly became the favorite love poems of the age. His second work, famous work, is The Wish. In this, nature is common aspect in his poem inspiration. This work considered nature as his source of inspiration. In his poem, The Wish, Kavli appears as a nature, in his poem, The Wish, Kavli appears as a nature protector and lover. He has a wish, which is to live alone with nature and far away from city and people. He explained his wish in five stanzas. In each stanza, he gives nature, which is the countryside, a beautiful image. Here my references. Thank you.
Yeah, show your references. Yeah. I'm not able to see in the Google Classroom. Okay. Okay, so your performance in Google Classroom is quite good. On the positive side of the class average, that is 77%. Okay, and by and large, you have regularly submitted all your work also, bearing a couple of work. Initially, there was lots of done late, yes, but later on, things improved. And so I hope your presentations were also good, well worked out presentations were presented here. Okay? So keep doing the work in a similar way in all other semesters also.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, Stuti, second last. After this, we will have Bhargavi.
Hello, sir.
Hi, yes.
My screen is visible, sir.
Hi, yes, it is visible. You have to pin up the screen. If you can again share, it will be good. Yeah, share again, then it will be good. Yeah. Yes, share again, reshare your screen. Are you sharing, Stuti?
Sir, network issue.
Just a minute. Okay. Anybody else can do that? Anybody? Have you shared with anybody else who can share the screen?
No, sir.
So if you can.
Stuti, send me. I will share your screen.
Okay.
So by that time we are taking turn of Bhargavi. Bhargavi, are you ready?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So after this we will take Stuti's turn.
My screen is visible, sir?
Yeah, it is visible, yes.
Okay. Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. Today is my topic is a Victorian novel. First topic, a pen pictures of the Victorian society that is found in the novels of Victorian writers. Victorian era. The Victorian era of the British history was the period of Queen Victoria's regime from 1837 until her death in 1901. It was a long period of peace, prosperity, refined culture, great advancements and technology, and national self-confidence for Britain. The Victorian era was the greatest age of English novel. The novel as a genre rose to entertain the rising middle class and to depict the contemporary life of changing society. The Victorian period of English history witnesses a set of complex political, social, scientific and philosophical developments. Some of the Victorian period novelists named in the below: Charles Dickens, William Thackeray, Thomas Hardy, William Morris, Elizabeth Gaskell, George Eliot, Annie Bronte, Charlotte Bronte, Emily Bronte. Four types of writing were popular during the Victorian era. The first, realist, naturalist, the novel and poetry. Now I am going to discuss a pen picture of Victorian society that I find in the novels of Victorian writers. First, Charles Dickens. Charles John Hotham's Dickens was an Victorian novelist and social satirist, generally regarded as the greatest novelist of Victorian period. Dickens show a compassion and empathy toward the vulnerable and advantaged segments of English society and contributed to several important social reforms. Characteristics of Charles Dickens novels. The title of novel was extremely important to Dickens. Dickens criticized Victorians for considering low class inadequate. Dickens used suspense and mystery. Dickens used comedy as relief from the serious and unhappy section of his novel. Second is Thomas Hardy. Thomas Hardy must be regarded as a key for Fournier of the Victorian novelist in literature. His Tale of Three Arbuckles is a famous novel. Is a simple girl who is preyed upon by an aristocratic menace. He show here to escape his idols on the morals and Victorian society. Characteristics of human Thomas Hardy novels. Hardy used several literary devices and themes to express his ideas stylistically by four shadows, symbolism, marriage, and different philosopher. Hardy's tragic vision manifested in major novels. Hardy's convictions that there is a fundamental conflict between humanity and the fatherless first. A woman novelist of the Victorian era. The era show a proliferation of women writers. The novels as a genre was initially seen as feminine literature, and literacy rate among women increased, a new need for women writers catering to his segment was answered by these writers. Elizabeth Gaskell, popularly called Mrs. Gaskell, wrote short stories and novels that dealt with presenting a social picture of her society in the 1850s. While it was a time when doubts about material progress reaching the actual lives of the ordinary men were starting to be raised, Gaskell mostly gave an optimistic view of the time. Characteristics of Gaskell novels. She was accomplished in writing novels, novellas, short story, and poems also. So it's fair to say she made a good use for her talent. She was most famous for writing ghost stories like Wives and Daughters, North and South. Thank you, sir.
Okay, so still by and large you are reading all the word by word slides, okay, so that you need to improve in the next semester, and your Google Classroom performance also needs to be improved. It is around 60% right now, that is below the classroom average. If you see few students, because of which entire classroom average is down. If you perform poor, then your classroom average also is down. If you perform better, then the classroom average is also good. So if classroom average is around 70, then we can say that this student's performance, like Aditi, only 26%. Aditi is lowest, and it is only 26%. Anjali is second lowest, only 36%. And then Stuti is the third one, 48% in performance, and fourth is Bhargavi with 59-60%. So because of your performances, the entire classroom performance is low, okay? So in next semester, to all four, and Bhargavi to you also, be regular classroom attendance. Now obviously you will have to come physically, maybe from the second semester. Things will open from last week of February, so everybody will have to come to department. But at the same time, all this work in Google Classroom should be done in due time, whenever the assignments are given. In your work, we can see that lots of works are done late. Almost all the works are done late. If I share a screen, and if you're able to see, so it's very small letters, so I don't know whether you'll be able to see it or not. But you see that below the marks, some instructions are written. It is done late. So all these works are done late. So that is how it reflects that you were initially not regular. Everywhere not turned in, done late, missing. Some of your tasks are missing also. One only, okay, right now is missing. And the others are to be done now, with the due dates are coming on 14th and 15th also. So see this, that in next semester, we don't have to instruct anybody personally that your work is not regularly done. Okay, so the next presenter, last one for the day, is Stuti.
Hello, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, let me remind you to keep on asking question in the chat. Keep asking question in the chat and you have to answer also. Yes, Tuti, you can start now.
Okay, sir. Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. My topic is characteristic of neoclassical literature. Neoclassical means neoclassical period tried to imitate the style of the Roman and Greek. Thus, the combinations of the term neo means new and classical means as in the day of the Roman and Greek classics. Broken into three part, neoclassical literature was written between 1660 and 1798. This time period is broken into three part. First one is Restoration period. The second is the Augustan era, and the age of Johnson. The neoclassical period of literature is also known as the Enlightenment period. Literature can be broadly divided into age, starting from the Middle Age, Renaissance, Neoclassical period, Romantic period, Modern period, to the past modern period. First is in the Restoration period. Restoration period in after the beheading of King Charles I, the monarchy are restored, and so this period got name Restoration. The Restoration period lasted. Restoration period lasted from 1660 and 1700. Written of this age, Dryden and Milton, grounded and impressive style, scholarly allusions and mythology and the intense use of imagination. The second one is the Augustan era. The Augustan era is also called the age of Pope. Cole was the leading poet in this age. The Augustan age lasted from 1700 and 1750. And last is the age of Johnson. The age of Johnson lasted up to 1798, when the Romantic movement was underway with the publications of lyrical ballad and Wordsworth and Samuel Coleridge. Classical neoclassicism introductions, main characteristic, main figure in three poets, John Dryden, Alexander Pope, and Samuel Johnson. Characteristic introductions written between 1660 and 1798, nestled between Renaissance and Romantic, the era of Enlightenment. The term neo means new, while classical refers to the Roman and Greek. Emulate the Greek and Roman style of writing. It is movement against too much use of individualism and imagination in literature. The Victorian of classical rule and religions, characteristic of neoclassical literature. Neoclassical literature was defined by common sense, order, accuracy, and structure. Their character also practiced practiced conservatism, self-control and restraint. A large number of literary work came out during this period, which included fables, melodrama, rhyming and couplet, satire, letters, diary, novel and essay. Influence of classics. Write a look back to the idea and art from the classical time and political and social affair. They were guided by the wisdom of the past. Influence of the classical. The period is called neoclassical because it written look back to the ideas was art form of classical light classical time, emphasizing even more than their renaissance and the classical ideas of order and rational control. The classical value, the neoclassical emphasize upon the classical value of objectivity, impersonality, decorum, balance, harmony, proportions, and moderations. Characteristic of neoclassicism, Aristotle is nations of probability and the unities. The neoclassical might be thought of as to the Aristotelian's nations of probability, as well as the unity of actions, time and place. Nature of literature. The neoclassical writers reframed the literary composition as a rational and rule bound process requiring a great deal of craft, labor, and study. Neoclassical literature is characteristic by order, occurrence, and structure in direct oppositions of Renaissance attitude, where men seen as basically good. The neoclassical writer a man is inherently flawed, and nature of the literature. The neoclassical literature gave more importance to social need compared to individual needs. They believe that men can find meaning in social, religion, nature, order, government, and literature. Imitation and nature, two of the concept center of the neoclassical literature. Theory and practice were imitation and nature, which was intimately related. Imitations according to Plato is a mere copy of life. It is a copy of copy. Aristotle said that imitation is a not a mere photostat copy of the life or the world, but it is a recreation's idea, but idea copy of the world. Imitation and the second nature, the harmonium order of the universe, including the various social and political, including the world social and political hierarchy within the world. Characteristic of neoclassicism, nature had a deep moral significance, comprehending the modes and actions that were permissible and excluding certain action as unnatural, unnatural. Clearly, the neoclassical vision of nature was very different from the meaning later give to it by romantic. Neoclassical characteristic of neoclassicism nature of literature. The neoclassical writer is literary compositions as a rationals and rule bound process and requiring a great deal and craft label and study the typical words from the Alexandrine in French and heroic couplet in French. In conclusion, thus we can say that such characteristics were there during 18th century, which were reflected by play, drama, novel, poetry, and other literary art, reflections of society and behavior of contemporary time. This is my citation, sir. Thank you.
Okay, good. You are still reading a lot, okay? So, yes, you can stop presenting the slides. So you are reading a lot, okay, first semester, so it is okay. But coming down to second semester, we hope that you will speak orally, a few more things also. And as informed earlier, your Google Classroom performance also is not up to the mark. We expect that your work is done with regularity, at least. First very important thing is being regular, then quality, then qualitative work also is there. So you see in the screen that I am sharing that four tasks are still missing and many more tasks are still pending here. So lots of tasks are pending, so which are to be completed, and you have 48%, which is quite low in classroom performance. So this you need to improve. So in the coming days, you have to complete your Google Classroom work also. You have to complete your assignment, take home test, and also prepare for university exam. So during the semester, if you do not remain regular, then at the end of the semester, there is lots of burden. Right now, your priority is university exam. You have to prepare for that. But then if the work is pending, then you have to give time to that also. So right from the beginning, during the semester studies, be careful that nothing is pending. Everything is done in due time. Okay, so that was the last presentation of our 5 days long journey into this presentation season. And it was a great listening to all of you. During our live classes, we kept on telling that somebody come online and speak. But there were very few students like Nidhi, Daya, Riddhi. They were keeping their camera on. Otherwise, everybody were keeping their cameras off. And some of them were replying like Bhavyang, Jignesh, Kishan. Some of them were answering time and again also. Many of you remained silent, completely silent. Most of you remained. So this was the first time that I listened all of you in detail. So how do you look? That also I have seen first time. Many of you have not shown your face. Some of you came to department for 1, 2, or 3 days. But many of you were completely unknown. So the first time I have seen. So it's a very curious time. Corona times are very curious, where you are meeting students first time at the end of the semester. Almost the entire semester you taught. And then at the end, you are seeing that how the students are looking. And how are they speaking? How are they performing? That all was not seen during live interactions. So that is, again, hopefully things will not be online in the second semester. But in case there are hybrid mode, then also keep a habit of keeping camera on. Keep a habit of doing interaction in one or the other ways also. These are very important skills in this time of work from home. Now we have to prepare people from work from home also. So work from home is talking with camera and digital devices. So that also is a necessary skill. And I hope in last 5 days, all of you might have got a kind of a first-hand experience of working with all these devices. Many of you, those who were not coming online with camera on or not talking, you all got an exposure, like preparing slides, sharing slides, talking, answering. So you all have learned a little bit of skills in what we know as, what we call it as work from home skills. Those skills also you might have learned in last 5 days. Well, a reminder to everybody, your identity cards are here in the department now ready. So you have to pay rupees 30 to clerk and collect your card, or anybody on your behalf can also come and collect the card. In case you come to submit your assignments, take home test or written assignment, at that time also you can collect, but contact the clerk at which time he will remain present. So you don't have to wait, because now you have only 7 days left for your university exam. So you have to very quickly now prepare for your university exam, and you can't waste your time in any other things. So ask him that at which time he will remain present. So accordingly, you can come and collect your iCard and submit your assignments also. If any of your family members are coming, then they also can come. There is no other documents required to show, just a signature, and they can collect the iCard on your behalf. But be careful that the iCard is not lost. We won't be able to prepare overnight another iCard. And in exam, you will require the iCard. The exam centers may not give you an entry without identity card. So do not forget to carry your identity card also during the examinations. Take home test, I think everything is very clear to you what you have to do. So you have to submit a copy, a scanned copy of handwritten take home test in Google Classroom, and one copy you have to submit here in department. Assignment, your assignment is to be submitted. So that can be blogged and submitted in Google Classroom, and one printed copy of typed one or handwritten one. You have an alternative option there, but in take home test, it is compulsorily handwritten one. Complete your Google Classroom work also. Lots of work will get completed within 15th or 16th, so that you complete. Your academic writing course is going on, so whatever assignments are there now, you can also take a break now from that. You can take a break and now concentrate on your exams. And after your exam, you can complete your incomplete works in academic writing course. The final submission shall be done in the first week of March. The final submission for the first week of March. So till then, you can take a break if your other works are completed in that course there. Okay, so these are a few reminders. And now in this semester, we are not going to see each other. Now we will meet in second semester. You will be in second semester, and then our meeting will be this. So this is our last meeting here in this online platform. Even in the offline classes won't be there, but you will be completing all your work in subsequent times there. Okay? So wish you all the best to everybody for your university exams and all the internal assignments that you have to submit. Wish you all the best for your upcoming academic activities.
Thank you, sir.
So we are ending our session now here.